Morning, ladies and gentlemen. Standing before you is Ms. Mashilwane from the Logistics Department at VAL University of Technology, Vanderbijl Park Campus. Today we're looking at Business Management 1, Chapter 6, Leading. Remember the previous chapter, we were talking organizing, and then now we're talking leading. Remember, we're still talking the management tasks. And then just to give you an overview of leading, when we're talking leading, this is actually about influencing, motivating, and also enabling others to contribute toward the effectiveness and success of the organization which they are members of. In other words, leaders actually motivate others through encouragement, communication, and other tactics to empower individual and groups to achieve challenging objectives. And secondly, they also enable this change through allocating resources and other aspects necessary so that employees can actually achieve the organization's goals and objectives. Now, we're going to look at the different components of leadership. Now, we have what we refer to as a leader, we have what we refer to as a follower, and we also have the situation, which is probably the environment. Now, when we are talking of a leader, this is the one, or rather, this is the person who gets the process of the crowd. In other words, this is the person who makes sure that something happens as a result of the interaction between the leader and the follower. And then now, when we're talking the follower, this is the organized group, perhaps your employees. And then now we're taking the situation, and then now this is the given set of circumstances as well as your environment, both internal and external, in which the organization functions. And then now what you need to know is that when leaders are ineffective, their influence does not contribute to and often detracts the goal, or rather the goal achievements of the organization. And then we're going to look at the interactive framework of leadership. Now, remember, we define the leader and we also define the follower and the situation as well. Now, what you need to know is that with the leader comes to the table as an individual with a unique personal history, interest, as well as characteristics. And then now, with the follower, it is actually probably the opposite of that, because now this person actually brings about expectations, maturity levels, and skills will also affect leadership. So there is actually movement from the leader downwards to the followers, and upwards from the followers, helping in the process of problem solving. Because obviously, as a follower, remember, you are expecting to take orders from the lead, isn't it? And then now, when we're looking at the situation, we're looking the right behavior in one situation is not necessarily the right behavior in another situation. Remember, you can actually handle different situations in different manners. So it depends on the kind of situation that you are faced with at that particular moment. And then now we're looking at leadership versus management. Now, it is actually a well-known thing that leadership is not the same as management. Now, management is actually wider than leadership, because the manager is actually responsible for more tasks than leading. And then in addition, a manager must also plan, organize, and also control. But then now, in a way, management is actually involved in everyday running of the business, while leadership actually brings about an inspiring and emotional element within the organization. Now, people who are managers, normally they are not necessarily leaders, because you know there's a saying that leaders are born and not made. So now, the other way around is that leaders in an organization may not necessarily be in a leadership position. Sometimes you find out that, okay, this person is a very good manager, but then he or she is not a good leader. So there is actually difference between a leader and a manager. Now, we're looking at elements of management and leadership. Now, we're still talking management versus leadership. Now, with your manager, this is someone who is an administrator. But then now, when you are looking at the leader, this is someone who is innovative. This is someone who creates things, who comes, remember, we have a leader and we have a follower. And then people actually, your followers actually expecting you as a leader to be an innovator, to come up with new things. And then with your management, they actually use authority to plan, organize, and also lead, to motivate as well. And then in, with your leadership, they actually motivate others to complete their tasks. And then in your management actually maintains, but then with your leadership, a leader actually develops. And then in management, actually monitor, or rather even a manager, they monitor people, but then a leader inspire people. And then a manager have a short-term view, but then with their leader, they actually have a long-term view. And then a manager actually asks how and when, but then the leader actually asks what and why. And then the management actually imitate. Remember, there are different types of the layers of management. You have your strategic managers, you have your functional managers, and you also have your operational managers. It depends on which hierarchy they are on. Probably if they are functional managers or your operational managers, they actually take orders from above. So they actually imitate. But then with your leaders, they're actually original, they originate. And then in your management, they accept the status quo and actually implements plans, but then with your leaders, they actually challenge the status quo and also initiate. They are initiators. And then in with your managers, they focus on systems and structures, but then in leaders actually focus on people. Remember, the most important thing in as far as leadership is concerned is the welfare of the people. And then in with your employees, they do things right. They do things right, according to book, according to as they are ordered. But then with the leaders, or rather, yes, leadership, they do the right things. Yes, they do the right thing. Some would actually ask, what is the difference between doing things right and doing the right things? But then when you do things right, you're actually following the plan. Like, this is, you got the plan to say, okay, this is what you need to do, this is how this is done. But then now, when you are a leader, remember, you are an innovator, you are a developer, you are doing the right thing. It's called, it has an element of integrity, doing the right things. So basically that is that. And then now we're going to look at the earlier leadership theories. And then the first one that we're going to look at the trait theories. And then those, I actually assume that good leaders were born, as I actually said earlier on, but not made, looking at the physical, social, and personal characteristics of people. And then in your behavior theories, actually distinguish between two broad groups of behavior. The first being people orientated, meaning they meet the emotional or social needs of employees. And then the second one is task orientated, meaning they focus on work methods as well as job to be done. And then in my favorite two, looking at your servant leadership theory. And then this actually the aim of this theory falls on serving others in order to let them experience fulfillment and growth. And then it's always about the other person. And then an example of this would be Jesus, because he was actually a servant leader. And then we're looking at the situational approaches theory. And then it is said that effective leadership is seen as a process of analyzing the situation and then choosing the best leadership style to actually suit it. And then we're looking at adaptation to meet employee skills as well as capabilities. And then an example would be soccer. And then we're looking now at new leadership theories. And then in the first one that we look at, we're looking at the rebirth of earlier trait theories. And then it is said here, the interest lies in the understanding that leaders' performance by trying to find what characteristics people think of when they say someone is a leader, like individual abilities, your codes of conduct, or even your principles for that matter. And then we're also looking at theory of charismatic leadership. And then the theory assumes that charisma is actually a trait of a leader. So basically, if you have that charisma, definitely you are considered as a leader according to this theory. And then in theory of transformational leadership, it looks at the set of abilities that allows a leader to recognize the need for change and also to create a vision of how to probably go on about achieving that particular change. And then we're looking at theory of transactional leadership, which suggests that all leaders use a combination of different leadership styles. And then these are actually other leadership theories. And then we're looking at the leader-member exchange theory, which focuses on the relationship between the leader and the follower rather than on their qualities. And then we're looking also at substitutes for leadership theory, which challenges the need to have a leader. The argument being that experienced followers can follow their own minds to actually fulfill tasks. So that is the take of that particular theory. And then we also have servant leadership theory, which suggests that if people believe in serving others rather than themselves, followers will then actually become wiser and more independent. And then we also have what we refer to as super leadership theory, which proposes that a leader can lead themselves. And then we also look at managerial leadership theory, which refers to the elements of a typical manager and that of a typical leader, comparing it to typical tasks and people-oriented traits, concluding that both are actually necessary. And then now we're looking at the four I's of transformational leadership theory. The four I's of transformational leadership theory. And then the first I, we're looking at idealized influence. And then it is said that transformational leadership actually behave in a way that makes the leaders the role models to their followers. That is idealized influence. Transformational leaders behave in a way that makes them the role models to their followers. And then we're looking again at inspiration. And then it is said that transformational leaders motivate and inspire their followers by giving meaning and challenge to their work. And then in the third eye, we're looking at intellectual simulation. And then it is said that transformational leaders stimulate their followers to think differently about their situation with new and creative ideas, because remember, we're taking intellectual stimulation. And then finally, the last I, we're taking individual consideration. Now, it is said that transformational leaders actually pay special attention to followers' individual needs to achieve both for achievement and growth by acting as mentors and coaches. So basically that is when you actually focus on individual followers or other individual employees to make sure that they actually grow and also achieve their goals or whatsoever. And then in now, these we're going to look at the leadership tools. And then the first one, we're looking at authority, we're looking at power, we're looking at responsibility, delegation, as well as authority, accountability. These are your leadership tools. Now, the first one, when we are talking authority, I think it might actually be familiar. This is the right of a manager to give reasonable commands to and expect action from his or her employees. That is authority. And then when we are talking power, this is the ability of a manager to influence the behavior of his or her employees. Because now, remember, he or she is in power. And then when we're taking responsibility, this is the duty a manager actually has to achieve set organizational goals. And then delegation, that is passing responsibility and authority for achieving goals down the line of command to employees when probably having subordinates and everything. And then in accountability, we're taking judging how well employees actually meet their responsibility. Because remember, at each and every organization, business, whatever, people have to be take account for their actions, isn't it? Mm-hmm. And then in now, we're looking at something very interesting, masculine and feminine leadership styles. We're looking at masculine and feminine leadership styles. Now, the first one, when we're taking feminine style, Most definitely. I think to a certain extent, someone would actually agree to say, when you are led by a feminine somebody, they are more cooperative. But then if it's someone who's masculine, they're more competitive. They want to actually throw their weight around. And then again, when you're taking feminine again leadership style, it's actually horizontal network and egalitarian as well. And then in masculine, it's vertical and hierarchical organizational structure. Remember, it's that your top approach. There's no like management. Inputs from your employees whatsoever. So you don't necessarily know what is happening on the ground, but then you only take decisions up there. You don't involve your employees. But then with your horizontal network, definitely you engage your employees and everything. And then with your feminine, again, you're looking at strong quality focus. But then in our masculine leadership style, on the other hand, only focuses on more winning. You want to win all the time. And then again, your feminine style, we're looking at more intuitive and subjective problem solving. But then on the other hand, with your masculine, you're more rational and objective problem solving approach. You're not about that. And then now when we're looking at your feminine leadership style, there's low control, there's a lot of empowerment and empathetic collaboration, and there's also collaboration. But then with your masculine, there's actually higher control. Remember, you want to actually display your power, who's more powerful and everything. And then it's also more strategic and unemotional, and it's also analytical. So basically, that is the end of our chapter.